The very easy way, wherever you are in this console, just with one finger, place it on the word session and hold it, and now the automation window opens up. Yes? On the word session, hold it on the word session, and now your automation opens up. And now you're in the automation window. You see there's one snapshot, but there's still a button available over here, and this button is called update. Of course, you didn't save this in this first snapshot. So if you press now the update button, which is over here in the line of snapshot one, now it disappears. And now we saved this nice horizontal line in snapshot one. Now I say, okay, let's get rid of the bass. You're playing too loud on stage, Slobodan, so I don't need you at front of house. Yeah, okay. And the two guitarists, they use these big Marshall sticks. We also don't need them. So let's get rid of them also. Yeah, okay. So, but the lead singer needs to be a bit louder. Okay, this is my next cool mix. So at the right bottom, I say insert new. And now I have a new mix. Yes, okay. Then I make a totally, completely different mix. Okay, cool. And I say insert new. And now I have three different mixes. Above my master fader, I have this nice camera, which can take snapshots or which can fire snapshots. And I move to the left. Hey, this is snapshot mix number two. This is mix number one. Yeah? Above your master fader on the right. Yeah? Can anybody find that? Yes, can you touch it and the faders will jump? The snapshot, the left and the right. Fire next snapshots, fire previous snapshots. And then your faders move. Yes? Okay, cool. Okay, but now we see three snapshots in front of us. We have now had snapshot one, but we don't play the second song. We want to skip to snapshot three. Now with the finger on the screen, I can select snapshot three. This is now gray. And at the end, I see the word fire. And when I press fire, it now moves from snapshot one to snapshot three. So I can wildly jump through my complete list. So I can select one of the snapshots, so I don't say I don't play the second one. Okay, yeah. Normally, what I also can do, which is very, very handy, when the director says to me, the third song, we're going to play that as second song. Press on the right-hand side, press edit. And then with your finger, hold the third snapshot. And drag and drop the third snapshot while you're holding the arrows. Drag it to the second position, or maybe to the first position. And now you see snapshot three, snapshot one, snapshot two. I don't want to call them three or two. So then I press rename, and then I can fill in, give them the weirdest names I want. Song one, song two, song three, or just the titles of the songs, or whatever the titles of the bands, which band it is. Press done, and then in. And on the right-hand side, when I press done now, and now at this moment, cool. I have my show. This is my new show. And press next, and I, in the right order, my shows. On the left-hand side, I have a button called update multiple. Let's say, the bass guitarist is sick today. He doesn't play at all. So the keyboard guy, he's playing some bass lines. So he's on channel one and two. That's the microphone. And on all snapshots, I want to kill these channels, because otherwise I will hear a hum. How do I solve this? When I have 99 snapshots, I have to do 99 edits. Well, I hate 99 edits. That's too much work and I'm lazy. So I press the button on the left-hand side, update multiple. I say just below it, edit all or select all. And now all my snapshots are selected and I make the change. So I change, channel one and two, bring them down, both mute them maybe. And at that moment, on the left-hand side, I press confirm. And now all my snapshots are updated. Wherever I am in my show, this change is made. It can be a volume change, it can be an EQ change, it can be anything. So I can select my complete show, yes? Okay. Now, don't look at your own console. Look at the screen, at the video screen. Because we just made a nice show, and you see my master volume is somewhere over here. Yes, my master volume is over. We did this in a club where people from our age come. Yeah. So now we have to do this. We have to do the same show, and we're going to do this show in a house with some elderly people, people of 70, 80 years old. So the first thing they ask during the first song, okay, we're now in song number one. The first thing they ask, oh, please, Softer Hoko, it's so loud, it's so loud. Fingers in their ears, because they sit of always, the elderly people sit in front of the speakers. That's always where they sit, okay? Yes, it's always the same, everywhere in the world. They want to see it, okay? But their ears are quite good, because they, ah, it has to be softer. Okay, cool. So we bring down the master fader. So the master fader always to the half of it. Okay, this is the first song. Okay, we're gonna play song number two. So, ah, okay, and here we go. One, two, three, song number two. So I play next snapshot. Look what happens to my master fader. It's up again. Okay. Okay. Now people who are experienced in digital consoles, you know what they say? Huh. You know what they say? The first thing what they say is, ah, now you have to go to the menu of the automation and you have to find the scope and the filters of the automation. Then you have to go to the settings of the group masters, and from the group master you have to find the master fader, and in the master fader you have to select the function master fader, and when you have to select the function master fader, turn it off, and you have to do that for every snapshot in the filter bank and the scope. Yeah, right. That's what sound designers love, because they can design all the show with thinking of programming and selecting away. But I can assure you, you can give me the answer what you have to do. Because, sorry? Yes, you can do the update mode, but you want to have a manual in control. You want to have a manual in control. It doesn't have to jump. Of course, there's one solution. Update all, bring them all to this lower volume, but sometimes you have to play with it and you would like to filter it out. Where is my problem? What is the problem? Is it the automation which is my problem? Yes, the Mr. Big sound designer would think that. But what did we learn today on any question? We want to change something. What is the first answer on all questions? Press the white button. So press the white button. Where is our problem today? Where is our problem? The master fader. So touch the master fader. And still we have on top the automation, so close the automation. So we see the master fader in front of us. So how do we change the master fader? It has something to do. The problem is with our master fader. So touch the data of the master fader, touch the top of it. And when we touch the top of it, I always told you, look to the screen, please. The black part which you see over, is always the data. But in the gray part and the top, that small line in the top, there you see all the construction data. And there you see the saves. It's a construction data, or it's a construction thing, of the master fader. So just, exactly. So press the save function and you see any function of the master fader you see there. And of course, at the right hand side, at the output, there's a function called fader. So now press the fader, and now it's red. Now the fader is a save mode. So if I go downwards and I go to my, level where all my faders are, and I jump to the next scene, previous scene, my fader is always in save mode. I can place it very loud, whatever, and it won't jump my fader. I can place it very soft and it won't jump. It's in manual control. This is exactly the same when I have a DJ or I have a presenter, and this is, ah, he takes microphone 6, the presenter, help! And in the next scene, in the next song, microphone 6 is off. And the other scene, microphone 6 is we're on again, very loud. I have to do it on manual control. It's fully programmed. Don't panic. Go to that channel, select that channel, go to save, and press save, and that fader is per save. That's in manual control. If you play something in save mode, then it's out of the automation. It's on manual control. Yeah. There's one exception. It's always me. I'm lazy. And I hate automation. I want to have the complete band on a manual control. But what I do sometimes, I can explain this in a long way, but it's very easy. Let's go back. Press close all. Hold the session button, and when you hold the session button, there in the gray line, you see in the session menu, in the gray line, yeah, hold the word session, sorry, and you're in your snapshot automation mode, and you see the next to the word session, you see in the gray line the construction of the automation, because the black part is always the data of the automation. But in the construction strip, you see, hey, global scope. And if you just touch global scope, you see, hey, today we use all the automation. Everything is on in the automation. Do I want to use it? No, I hate automation. So I press the button called disable all. I don't use any automation. But, and now there's the thing what I always do. Cool, I have ballads, I have pop songs, and I have rockabilly songs. So what do I always have to do in the ballad? I have to adjust my snare reverb to make a kach. And I have in the rock songs, it should be kach, something like Phil Collins. Okay, and in my rockabilly songs, no reverb, so shut down the reverb. But in my rockabilly song, I need this short slapback delay on the voice. And in my ballad, I need it large hole from heaven on my voice. So I make three snapshots. And on all the three the snapshots, I make three different effects racks. Yes. And the only thing I do, turn all the automation off and I turn on my effects rack. And now we're turning on the effects rack. I make three complete different effects rack. And normally, when you are at your analog console, this is a ballad. You have to go to your lexicon, make the reverb longer, and then to go to this one, make the snare on my Yamaha PCM9 or whatever SPX90. You have the snare plate longer. We have been there. We all have the same effects rack, the SPX2000 nowadays or something like that, or what is it, TCM1, whatever the snare plate belong. No. You just make a ballad setting, a rock and roll setting, a pop setting, make a few snapshots of it. And when you do live bands, open up. And the only thing maybe what you can do, press effects menu. When you go to the effects menu, go to the studio delay, do the global tap function. And now this is how my mixer always looks like when I do a live band. Open up my faders. And the only thing is, this select the snapshot ballads, select the snapshot rock or snapshot pop. In the how many styles it will do, and I can do 1, 2, 3, 4, and my delays are always on time, and I have long reverbs and short reverbs, and only looking at one screen I can mix my complete 30 channel band. Yeah. Okay, last bit, and that's really the last bit. On the right hand side, you'll see channel 11 till 20 now over here. Okay, let's go to channel 11. Channel 11, open it, input 11, and we say the source will be maybe microphone number one. Here is microphone number one. If we select microphone number one, no, I don't want to do that because then I have to route 10 times. Okay, press ripple route, microphone one from 1 to 10, and then press route. And now on 11, there's microphone one, then microphone two, microphone four, three, four, and so go on from channel 11 to 20, we have input 1 to 10. We all can do that. Okay, go back to input 11, press close one time. Beneath the source input, so beneath the source input, just below it, you see recording send and recording return over here on the screen. Yes, just below the mic 1 input. When we touch recording send, it says not sent, but we see the Ubimadi at the moment already. And when you see the Ubimadi, hey, if I press ripple route, and send and return is already highlighted, so ripple route from 1 to 10, and then I press OK, the green one, route, and I go back one, I see that now, go to the input, there we are, microphone 1 is recorded on USB out 1, so it's sending to the laptop, it's recording track 1, and it's coming back also from track 1. So with this small button at the bottom, cool. We see an XLR plug. So we're listening to the XLR. If we press that one, hey, now we're listening to the tape, and you see even the arrow change. So if we want to listen to the audio which is recorded in the laptop, we have to go to the second channel, press also tape, and the third channel also tape. No, that's for 40 channels, pressing 40 buttons, and you know. I promised you we'll be lazy at the end of today. Yeah? Okay. Close this. And now, on the left-hand side, you remember the macro buttons we just placed. And you see over here, when you look at the screen, you see this button. Hey, cool. There's a tape button, there's a tape button, and there's a tape button. We did 3 channels. And we routed over here, microphone 1 to 10, and we sent the 10 channels to track 1 to 10 from the Ubimadi. Over here, I have my master buttons, all routed channels. If I press the XLR button, okay, there we are, all original inputs from the microphones. Yes? Now, if I press the tape button, listen to copied audio button, hey, all my channels now have this white sign of tape. Now I listen to tape. So with this one button, now I can do my virtual sound check for my laptop. Please remember one thing. When you did this, when the band comes back on stage, at the moment the band comes back on stage, don't forget to press the XLR button again, that you really want to have your live inputs. Otherwise, you listen to your laptop instead, you won't hear anything. Yes, at that moment. Okay, that's really cool. Okay. One thing, if you have any input, if you have two consoles, like a monitor and a front of house console, and you use them both from one rack, what is the issue that you will have? I'm in front of house somewhere over here, and the monitor guy is somewhere over there, and we share one rack. So digital cable to one console, digital cable. There is a problem that you have. When you control the analog gain of the input, you both share the same analog input. So this gain will be that gain. Yeah? And that's really a big issue. Because, well, not a big issue. If I hate this monitor, dude, I just put my fader down a little, I raise the gain a bit, all his monitors go to feedback, and the director says, okay, you go home. I'm going to be rid of it. Okay. Just imagine you always can protect the engineer. You always can use an advantage. Digico has a special system for it. Okay. Let's say, let's go to a layer where we didn't put some inputs. Let's go to the second layer. We have a microphone over here. This is my microphone, and I just use this microphone. Select one channel. Let's say, okay, let's select the input stage, and we use microphone. Where did I plug it in? I even don't know where did I plug it in. Maybe it's
channel 1.
Yeah. Okay. Let's plug it in the show. Let's forget it. I just show it on the screen. Yeah. Yeah, okay, this is cool. I did a lot of things, but okay, let's forget it. I have a channel which is plugged in, microphone one from the console. Okay, and now what I can do is select the channel next to it, also select channel 1. And this can be, of course, sometimes I have for the front of house, I need a little bit more high frequency. So this is for my front of house. If I do this on monitors, all my monitors will feedback. So if I do monitors and front of house from the same console, just double patch it to 2 channels. And on the channels where you do monitors, you only open the auxiliaries. So you do it double check. This is very, very easy. So here I open up the auxiliaries. Okay, cool. Open up the auxiliaries. Do the next one. Okay, this is all my monitor sends. And I don't open the fader, don't send it anywhere. Maybe in my input menu, I don't send it even to the master for safety reasons. So now I send these all. This is my monitor sent, and this is my front of house. It also can be 2 consoles who use the same input rack. And now I want to control my gain. Okay, let's go to the gain. Here we are, and I open up my gain. Well, I open up my gain. Okay, cool. My gain is now open, and now I'm touching the microphone. And if I listen to this one, okay, here we go. Just imagine we have audio now, because I did a lot of things. I changed a lot of things through the console, and now we have audio, and we see they're both on 28 dB. That's really cool. They're both on 28. It's the same gain. But if I do something at front of house, I also change the same thing at monitors. So a lot of manufacturers say, okay, we implement a digital trim. So that's not the analog gain, which is in the rack at our preamp. So press the gain. If we press the gain, so at the moment we press and then we rotate, we have an offset, which is the digital trim. And this trim is minus 40 dB and plus 40 dB. That should be enough. Let's bring it to the center. let's go to the channel which is not the boss. So the one, let's say, today the monitor engineer. It also can be around that the front of house, not the boss. But we decide that the front of house is the boss of the game today. Okay, let's go to the monitor, open it up. So touch the top of the channel and we open it up. Then we have, over here on the screen, you see the word input processing. At the bottom, you see the a switch, which is called game tracking. And it's now in off. Just press it, and now game tracking is on. And what is game tracking? Close this window. Well, game tracking brings on the screen a little green dot with an arrow in it. It's a green dot. But that's not the only thing. We are on analog gain. And you see over here, I'm on 27 dB, and the trim is 0 dB. Maybe you can switch to the all screen. And okay. Now I rotate the analog gain on the front of house channel and I bring it up maybe to 37 dB. And what does it automatically do? It corrects without hearing any difference. It corrects. So plus 10 dB on the gain will be minus 10 dB on the trim. It lets the monitor level stays exactly automatically. So what I do over here, this, it's doing that. It's counterclockwise. So it's compensating. And that's really cool, gain compensation. And that's like on safety or in insurance for the monitor guy. Yeah. So this is a real cool future, which all Digicos have from the start, the D1, D5, SD series, but it also works perfectly on the S21. And it's not seen in this price range consoles. It's a very cool future and you really can work this out. So separate processing for monitors for front of house on one console, or when you use multiple consoles, just on one rack, it always works like that. That's really cool. Cool. We should connect an iPad, so let's switch to the presentation. And if we connect an iPad, we'll do that in a minute. We come back after the presentation. Wait with it. Wait it for a minute. Can you wait? Please wait, Dragan, with it for a minute. When you connect the iPad. Can you please wait with it for a minute? When we switch to the iPads, how can you use the iPad? We deliberately made the iPad totally different. We made the iPad not a complete copy of the complete console. We're professionals, and as a professional, yeah, there's a lot of mixers for musicians, and for musicians, you can connect maybe 10 iPads to the console. But if we have this nice Labgruppen amplifiers or this nice D80 from D&B, and we have this M4 monitors, M6, M2 monitors, or whatever, with 130, maybe 142 dB already, do we want 142 dB in the hand of a guitarist, or a control on an iPad or an iPhone? Or do we want to stay? We are in the professional world. So if the professional world, we have one app for the engineers. And it has separate engineers pages for a real engineer from the professional world. Okay, cool. We can control. This is the page. This is the page which is meant for the plugger, the guy who is on stage. And he can do the inputs. He can patch inputs and he can give them names. Double click on the name and he can give them, okay, this is my hi-hat. And he can set up the gain. Ah, I need to plug in the 48 volts. I need to switch on the 48 volts, the phantom power, because there's an extra mic. First you decided two overheads and a kick, but you also need a snare and a hi-hat. So while the band is already playing, he's placing an extra mic on the stage and the plugger. And he's just hitting, okay, cool. And he's preparing my desk. While the band is already playing, he can make these changes. This is for the plugger. He can switch and he can make the setup, the gain. He can set up the trim. There's the page for the guy who is mixing. You can walk around. If it's a really beer event and everybody's drunk and throwing beer, you just keep your mixer backstage and you just walk around only with a good iPad, which is in a protected shield. And okay, you just walk around and you're safe. Your mixing console is safe. Yeah, okay. Okay, it's an affordable mixer, but not that affordable that it can drink beer. Yes, okay. Cool, so keep your mixer safe, walk around with an iPad with a cool cover around it. And you're safe, you can mix. So this is your front of house page. Select your bank and do the front of house mix. But with some clever functions like pen reset. Normally with this short, bring the panning back in the center. No, there's just the pen reset button. Reset it and it's reset it, or left to right. Cool. You can go to the equalizer, of course. There's a dynamics page, and there's, of course, a bus route page where you can do the bus routing very fast. The banks, you can switch the banks. If you want to do monitor mixing, go to the monitor so you have your mixer at front of house. And with the same mixer, you want to do monitors. The monitor engineer, or the one guy who is responsible, who is a real engineer, he can walk over the stage and he can do the monitor mix. So he selects the auxiliary and makes the mix. Select the auxiliary, makes the mix. Yeah, that's really cool. Okay. We'll connect it, the iPad in 2 minutes. I have two things to say. If you have any issue with the console or the S series or an SD series, whenever you are in the world, of course you are in Serbia over here. If you want to find the manual, well, the manual is always on the Digico website, digico.biz/support, and you can find for free any manual for a rack, for a console. You always can find the manuals over there. For this console, I think if you just watch this movie once, or you had this course once, you know everything. You can find anything, because we have 1, 2, 3, 4. What is causing the issue? Where is my problem? Touch the white button and I can find anything. Everything what's in the console, touch the white button and touch where you want to go. Number 2 is all data is at the top of the strip. Touch the top of the strip and I see all data in the black field. Want to change the construction, that's the gray line above it. Number 3 is hold something and I can control 20 at the same time. And number 4 is let's touch the EQ and this EQ opens up. Touch this compressor, it opens up. Just touch anything and touch and rotate or touch and slide. It's more touch and slide. Touch and rotate, that's for my granddad. Touch and slide. It's touch and slide is for our young engineers. Okay, cool. So that's the 1, 2, 3, 4 rule. But if you still have an issue, you always call your distributor. You have Dragon, you have Slobodan, you have the team available over here. In Serbia, we are really lucky. We have a great partner. They can do all the installs and they know about the software. They know about the consoles and know about the hardware. They can help you with anything. So they're more than happy to help you. And for some reason, if you cannot reach them, there's always a third level of support. Send an email to support at DigiConsoles and you're ready and we will help you in maybe a maximum a day, but maybe in a few hours you get an email back. Do it like this, do it like this, if it's not urgent. If you're really panicking and it's urgent, so yeah, yes. I really have an issue and this is really with a big SD setup, or are you really in panic, or something is not working. Of course, in the next slide, there's some other ways how to contact other persons, of course. But at the end of the story, there's this panic button and you want to touch the panic button. If you're really in panic, walk a circle around your console. Don't do a whole circle, do half a circle. When you're at the back of your console, next to where the serial number is, there's a telephone number on the back of your console. You can call this telephone number and that's the Digico support number, which is always available. Yes? Okay. Pick up your telephone, make a photo of this one. Any questions anywhere when this seminar is finished and you're at home and you still have some questions, on digico.biz you see all the information on the Digico Worldwide website. On digico.tv there's a lot of online trading. On youtube.com we do separate training videos for different, and maybe even the training of today will be available later on YouTube. You are living in Serbia. We have a nice distributor, I told you already, that's the website address. You can send me an email, ask me some questions, my email address is over there. And of course we are also on Facebook. Digico.official, that's the official Facebook site. You have the Digico users group. In the Digico user group, a lot of questions are asked from all around the world, but also you see the newest systems and new tips and tricks. So it's about tips, about tricks, nice photos from big setups all around the world. And but also you can ask your questions to other users. I have on the jaap.w.pronk Facebook address all my posts over Digico, some tips, some tricks, some nice where I am in the world. So you always can ask me the questions there via Messenger. So if you go home, please become friends with me. I will accept you the right way and I can answer all your questions. And of course, we have AVL Project, of course, like this seminar is now live streaming at the moment via the Facebook website of AVL Project. I thank you all for coming today. I just walk around. Slobodan walks around, and Dragon will walk around to help you with the iPad app, that you can see how the iPad works, what is really happening, to do some extra hands-on stuff. And thank you for coming. I will hand out for the few who I didn't give it this afternoon. I think you missed the cards. You already have my cards. If you want to meet me, you already have one. Yes. Okay. You don't have it. Here's my business card. Here are. And this was the official part of the seminar. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Okay. You already have connection? No. Okay. You just go to the main. You go to the main menu over here. And okay, there's your iPad. If you move one further, does it work? Yes, it already works. So you're there. There we are. You're there. Yeah, cool. Connection, that's it. And the only settings that you have to make is just over here in the iPad. You just fill in the IP address of that one. And in the iPad, you fill the IP address of this one. And of course, if you send over here on port 8000, it should be the receive port over there and the send port over here. Neither. Input, output, output, input, and fill in the IP address of this one over here and of this one over here. And that's this. Yeah, it's very simple. Yeah, and you select the page over here and then you control it. That's it. Yeah. Yeah. And of the channel which you select over here, that's the EQ you select. Yeah, that's it. That's it. Yeah. Yeah.